You see it in the headlines, you see it in the reviews. The brightness wars waged among TV brands has never been more intense. But what is this obsession with brightness on TVs? How bright does a TV even need to be? How much should you even care about brightness ratings when shopping for a new TV? Let's get into it. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Caleb Dennison, and whether you're a bona fide TV enthusiast or you've just started your journey into researching a new TV to buy, I think it's important that we have this conversation about TV brightness. I've known for a long time that this video needed to be made, and I'm excited that we're finally getting to it. And there's no better time, really. Take a look at what just went down at CES. On the grandiose side of the scale, we had TCL announcing a 110-inch TV with peak brightness poking up to the 5,000 nit level. And not to be outdone, Hisense announced a 10,000 nit, 115-inch TV. Meanwhile, both Samsung and LG touted their new OLED panels that promised to be just a smidge brighter than last year, but that was enough to get folks really excited. In the video super nerd world, some of us are very excited about a new 4,000 nit Sony mastering monitor that video pros could soon be using. So what is with all this brightness talk? How and why are brightness wars a thing? What is a nit and should you care? How has this become such a nituation? Come on, you had to see that coming, right? Well, for those of you who didn't get that objectively terrible joke, a nit is a unit of brightness, and it's used to express how bright a display can get. Nit is shorthand for the much more scientific measurement of candelas per meter squared. Now, you may have heard about lumens as a measurement of brightness and wondered why we don't apply those to TVs, especially when you see projectors with brightness capabilities expressed in lumens. Well, the reason is that lumens are applied to things like lamps or light bulbs and their ability to shine light in all directions. Nits, by contrast, he's hot, folks. Nits are used when the light is highly directional. This is why projector lamps are measured in lumens, but the brightness coming off a projector screen is measured in nits, just like a TV, laptop, computer monitor, or phone. Anyway, how many nits a display can put out has, for better or worse, become a yardstick for quality. In some ways, that's kind of fun, but in other ways, it's a problem. I'm gonna explain why soon, and we're gonna get into whether you should even give a nit about all this. Anyone? Yeah? No? Okay, where was I? We'll get into all of that, and by the time we're done here, you're gonna be a TV brightness expert. But before we get into the nits and bolts, let's talk about how we got to this point. And spoiler alert, it's me. Hi, I'm the problem. It's me. Well, at least a little nit. Man, where are all these crickets coming from? Okay, first off, we've got to acknowledge that brightness is just exciting, right? We know this. Humans love bright, shiny things. It's just built into us. I'm sure there's a deep scientific explanation for that, but for now, all we have to do is acknowledge this well-known truth. When it comes to TVs and other displays, brightness plays a role in visibility, yeah, but in terms of what makes a picture look attractive to us, it's the brightness against darkness, or contrast, that really lights up our excitement. This is because contrast is the element of image quality that has, by far, the highest degree of impact on us. You know who knew this perhaps better than anyone? Ansel freaking Adams, an American photographer who made a career out of producing stunning black and white photos. Just take a look at some of his work and it becomes clear that color, while quite enjoyable, is not required for beautiful imagery. These black and white images are gorgeous because of, you got it, contrast. So understanding that contrast has such a high impact on picture quality and that brightness plays a huge role in achieving stunning contrast, you can understand why TV brands and TV fans would get excited at the prospect of TVs that have the capability of achieving higher and higher levels of brightness. And that's where folks like me, TV reviewers and tech journalists, come in. We have a sort of chicken or the egg situation going on here. I don't know if TV brands started it or if TV reviewers and tech journalists started it, but at some point, how many nits a TV could put out became the most exciting spec to talk about. to the point that Nit became a fixture in headlines around new TVs. I know I've been responsible for trumping up Nit ratings in articles and videos for years now. And in fact, the Nit has become so inextricably linked with enthusiasm for TVs that I nicknamed my fans Nit Nerds, and then set about creating a line of merch around that brand. Check out our Nit Nerd merch by clicking the merch store link below. Shout out my fellow Nit Nerds. But guys, where does it end? How bright is bright enough? Do we really need all this brightness? And at what point is the brightness of a TV gonna morph from an asset to a liability? Well, to answer those questions, we first need to talk about the different ways brightness is used in TVs. Now, Nit Nerds, sit tight or skip to the next section because I need to take a quick moment to explain the difference between average picture level and specular highlights. Average picture level, or APL, as we say in the industry, refers to the average brightness of an image on a display. From the content creation side of things, we can point to TV shows like Game of Thrones, House of the Dragon, and The Witcher as shows that have a lot of low APL scenes. In other words, they just look dim to a lot of folks. Some may say, and they have, they are at times unwatchably dark. On the opposite side of the spectrum, we have high APL content, such as Burn Notice and Death in Paradise, sun-drenched shows that are bright, vivid, and colorful by nature. Now, a properly set up TV will make these shows look as the creators intended them to, but lots of us just like bright images, so we may crank up the brightness to get a higher APL out of our TV. On the other hand, some of us need our TVs to have a lower APL because we watch in a dedicated dark media room, or maybe at night in our bedrooms where a TV set to put out a high APL would simply be uncomfortable to watch. You don't want to be squinting the whole time you're watching shows, movies, or games, right? Most TVs today can be dimmed so that they have a low enough APL to be comfortable. But for those of us who need our TV to be really bright, maybe because the TV is often watched during the day in a sun-soaked room, how bright a TV can get in terms of APL is very important. I mean, I think we've all gone outside on a sunny day and had difficulty seeing our phone or laptop screens if they weren't set to be bright enough, right? Same deal with your TV inside, or outside, come to think of it. You need your TV to be bright enough to be visible, let alone have any contrast in bright environments. That's why outdoor TVs especially market their high brightness as a big attribute. My point is that some folks want a TV to have a high peak brightness capability, not because they want the whole screen to sear their eyeballs, though there are some out there who do want that and always use the Vivid picture preset on their TVs to get it. No, it's because they want to see that super contrasty image that can only come from having very high brightness objects in an image. We call the small high brightness areas specular highlights. And examples of this might be the sun gleaming off the chrome of a car, or the stadium lights gleaming off a football helmet. It could also be a super bright candle in an otherwise dark room. Further still, some folks want a TV that can have a high average picture level and still have enough power in reserves to put out high impact specular highlights. So if we wrap that all up, we have basically four scenarios that illustrate how brightness can be used in a TV. One may be a small bright object in an otherwise dark background, or a small bright object in a well-lit scene. Or it could be a large bright object on a well-lit background. That last one, large bright object on a well-lit background, can be especially hard for a TV to pull off well. But when it's done right, it can be downright dazzling, especially when you can get that HDR highlight impression in a room with the lights on. Now, I explain all of that in support of two important points about TV brightness. One, a TV's high peak brightness ability, or high nit rating, isn't just about whether a TV can light up your whole neighborhood on a dark night or sear your retinas like the sun itself. It's about being able to replicate the kind of sparkle and contrast we often see in real life. And then two, when we worry about whether a TV is going to be too bright, what we're really worried about is how the TV will use its brightness power, which leads us into the next critical point of this discussion. Stan Lee once wrote for a Spider-Man comic, "With great power comes great responsibility." And yeah, perhaps I've overused this trope when talking about TV brightness, but it really does apply. When we see TVs brands claims about how bright their TVs can get, it's fair to get excited. But we should also mix in a fair amount of skepticism. Because the real question is, will a TV use its power for good or for evil? Some scientists probably spent no small amount of time determining that, in the right situations, 10,000 nits was a magic number for HDR highlights in demanding situations. Situations for the home, I mean. We're not talking about commercial signage here. Until just a few months ago, a TV achieving up to 10,000 nits peak output was a pipe dream. I honestly didn't think we'd see a TV that could punch that hard for a few more years. I was as shocked as anyone that Hisense said it was going to deliver a 2024 TV that could deliver that. And frankly, I remain skeptical until I've actually seen it myself in this room. It's important to understand that such a brightness claim is tied to a measurement standard that involves taking measurements from a very small spot on a screen. Here's what a 10% white window looks like on a 65-inch TV. This is what a 5% window looks like. This is how big a 3% window is. And finally, here is a 1% window. When TCL says its TV will do 5,000 nits, I believe that claim is based on a testing methodology that sees the TV doing nothing else other than displaying a white window at either 3% or even 1%. Same for Hisense and their claim of 10,000 nits. I'm willing to bet that's a 1% window where all the TV's power is going into this one thing. Light up the whole TV with an image of the beach, sun sparkling off the water, and those specular highlights are unlikely to get up to 5,000 or 10,000 nits on those TVs I just mentioned. But that's true of any TV's brightness rating. That peak brightness claim is based on ideal conditions with virtually no other strain of responsibility on the TV. However, when we talk about high peak brightness capability, we also know that with that higher rating, a TV can also achieve a super high average picture level relative to TVs that are rated with a lower peak brightness number. So we can assume that these new flagship TVs from TCL, Hisense, and others will be able to have both punchy HDR highlights and generally super bright screens if we want them to be. Question is, will they do the job well? And the job I'm referring to here is something called tone mapping. Tone mapping, which I'm about to explain for you, has to be thought of differently now than it used to be. Until now, the content that we get would often contain brightness information that was beyond a TV's capability. For example, the movie Batman vs. Superman. It was mastered to 4,000 nits, meaning this disc right here has information on it that spans from pure black all the way up to 4,000 nits of peak brightness. That 4,000 nit information is pretty scant. It probably comes up just a few times in the movie, like here. The thing is, up until now, there weren't any TVs that could do 4,000 nits. So then, what does the TV do when it gets instructions that it can't execute? It does the tone mapping job. Tone mapping is the process in which a TV's processor has to take the brightness information it's getting from a piece of content, whether that's a show on Netflix or a 4K Blu-ray disc, and make it work on a TV, even though it can't get that bright. I think the best illustration I can offer uses a ruler or a tape measure. Let's say a brightness range of 0 to 4,000 nits can be represented by 4 feet worth of this tape measure. That's the signal coming from the Batman versus Superman disc, right? And each of these little lines, the inches or centimeters, whatever, those are increments of brightness. So we'll say each inch up the tape measure is just a bit brighter than the one before it. Now let's say we have a TV that has a peak brightness of 2,500 nits, well under 4,000. That would look like this on our tape measure. The challenge here is to take that 4,000 nits worth of tape measure, not just the total length, but the space in between each of these little increments, and scale it down so that it fits within this shorter space. We have to figure out how to fit 4,000 nits of range into a 2,500 nit space. And not only are we gonna have to drop the ceiling, so to speak, but we're gonna wanna keep all these increments in here. So we'll have to make the distance between those increments even shorter. We'll have to make the inches closer together. I hope that makes sense, because that's what a TV's tone mapping does, or at least one of the things it does. It also has to do this job in reverse. The truth is, most of the content we get is mastered to 1,000 nits, and there are lots of TVs that can get well brighter than that. So the art here is in taking the 1,000 nit signal and expanding it up to, say, 2,500 nits. So we now raise the ceiling and we make the space in between the increments, the distance between the inch marks, greater so that we can have equal size steps from the bottom to the top. Now just take that idea and scale it up, way up. If most of the content we can get is at 1,000 nits, then a TV with 5,000 nits is gonna have to do a lot of stretching and scaling, tone mapping. A TV with 10,000 nits, it's just doing a bigger version of that same job, but that job of tone mapping is definitely a little harder. Now, we've already seen that how good a TV is at this tone mapping job can vary wildly. Some TVs are exceptionally good at it, while other TVs have left a lot to be desired. And while companies like Sony and LG have historically done a really impressive job of tone mapping, it was only recently that Hisense and TCL stepped up their tone mapping game, and this was when the stakes were quite a bit lower. So again, the question shouldn't be about whether a TV is made to be too bright. The question is whether that TV can use its power judiciously so that we get a good experience out of that brightness, not one that makes us need to squint or put on shades. So for all of you out there who may have thought, I feel like my TV is too bright as it is, why in the world would I want a brighter TV? I'll just get blasted out of the room. Well, to you, I would say your TV needs adjustment, or it needs to do a better job of tone mapping. Because when a TV is doing its thing well, it will keep the APL at a comfortable level while delivering sparkling HDR highlights, so you get a gorgeous, high contrast, yet comfortable viewing experience. Time will tell whether 2024 TVs will do right by us with all this brightness power. And we won't have to wait too long to find out. My reviews of these TVs will be starting in just a few short weeks. So if you're excited to see how all this shakes out, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss those reviews, because I'm gonna make TV brightness and tone mapping one of the cornerstones of every review I do this year. I think it's the least I can do after shouting out about nits through this big old megaphone that I've got. Thanks as always for watching, everyone. Did you find this video helpful? Illuminating even? Come on, for sure you saw that one coming. Hey, do me a favor and drop a comment for me down below on what you think. Smash this video with a like if you dug it. Subscribe to see more. I'll see you on the next one. And until then, here's two other videos I think you might like.